Good check with Anya. It's all up here. It's all, she's the head of the service, so.
Oh, all right.
Yeah, she's got it.
Right, let me make sure your number was right.
Do you see it there? And I'll mark it here. It's a pretty simple. Let's see, where did she go? All right. So after I say strong, wise, and loving people we truly are and can become, and then grant us the strength, you know, somewhere around it. And I'll just look over to you and give you a nod. A nod. Stopped at 6:44.
That's
Scotty dog. MG.
Thank you.
morning.
Good morning.
And Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Thanks. My name is Michael Gilch. My pronouns are he, him, and his. And I'm glad to welcome you here to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation at Montclair this morning, whether you're joining us here in the sanctuary or streaming live at home. If you are here in the sanctuary, a reminder to put your cell phones on silent, or better yet, off, and make sure they're off the UUCM Wi-Fi, as it can bog down our bandwidth, which we need for our streaming. A reminder that our COVID reopening guidelines encourage no congregational singing, instead humming along with our hymn leaders, who today, speaking of, are Paul Lombardo and Juliana Carr Lombardo. Please join us in our opening hymn, number 210, Wade in the Water.
In the water. pretty interesting to sing, "We are building a new way," looking out on a congregation wearing masks, completely socially distant, not allowed to sing, just allowed to hum. Yeah, we are building a new way. It feels very honest to sing that this morning. Whoever you are, wherever you come from, whatever age, ability, history, identity, gender, or sexual orientation, you are welcome to bring your full self here. I'm Reverend Anya, and my pronouns are she and her. Grounded in faith, we come together to nurture the soul, inspire hope, and bring into being a more just and loving world. Today's service, "I'm Going to Do a New Thing," invites us to release the past year, may it be so, and embrace the new. Later in the service, we'll have a fire communion where we can release something, some habit, some struggle, some pain, and watch it be consumed by flame. Joining us to offer pastoral support for our in-person service from our pastoral care team is Zilka Springgoren. Zilka is in the back wearing the gold stole and waving. You'll know our pastoral care team members by those bright gold stoles, even though some of them are giving me a hard time about that because they say that gold is not their color. We'll work on that. Please reach out to Zilka for support and for connection. Our COVID protocols include social distancing and that we be masked and, as possible, vaxxed. We have restricted congregational singing, asking that we hum while our hymn leaders sing. We welcome and encourage families to attend, so we have reserved some special spaces solely for families. We are so glad that you are here. We know that children bring energy and volume, and we see both as a blessing. And if your family would prefer a little bit more space, you are welcome to engage the service in Fletcher Hall, which is through those doors. And we have restricted, Connection Cafe follows our service virtually via Zoom at 11:30. Please see your This Week at UUCM bulletin for other important information. And now we welcome Judith Hogan, our Religious Education Director, for our Congregational Connection.
Good morning, everyone. Let's see, I'd like to talk to you a little bit about what's going on in religious education. Today's service is about doing new things, so we thought it would be appropriate to share in today's Congregational Connection about new things that we're doing in religious education. This pandemic has demanded change across congregational life, perhaps no more decidedly anywhere than in religious education. Our children and our youth are facing trauma and challenge, and our program needed to alter to adjust. The new things that we're doing in religious education, actually the entire program is new. We are focusing on a heart-centered approach, aiming at pastoral care. Mm-hmm. A lot of people, and children especially, are experiencing differences in the way they just do everything in their lives. And so we wanted to offer them an experiential learning environment where we are focusing on our six sources and our eight principles. A lot of people didn't even know that Unitarian Universalists have six sources, and we are going to start them young by learning this now. I've asked one of our youth to answer a few questions, and I'll tell you the questions and then I'll read her answers. I've asked Alyssa Chan to answer which RE activity group that she participated in, how she felt about the new version of RE, what was an RE experience that she had that she really enjoyed, and what she learned that was new. Alyssa's answers are, "My name is Alyssa Chan, she, her, hers, and in the first trimester I mainly did Creative Edge, but I also did Into the Woods once. I really feel good about the new version of RE. It's fun, and I get excited about what we're going to do. And I get to be with lots of different kids, including older kids, which I like. I learned a lot this trimester. One thing I learned into the woods was how how to look up different kinds of leaves in an app on my phone. We learned about maple leaves. I also liked that we played frisbee on the lawn of Hillside during our class. We did so many fun things in Creative Edge. I got to paint a rutabaga. One time we walked around outside and took pictures. I took a picture of up close of a large crack in the sidewalk and thought about how I am as a person. But the most fun was playing and getting to play different musical instruments than having a band perform for ourselves at the end of every class. That's the kind of new things that we're doing in religious education. And the children and their faces are so happy and smiling at the end of every activity. And I appreciate that.
Let's say some words of gratitude. Thank you so much, Judith Hogan, for all your work in religious education. We celebrate you and the children. Ours is a covenantal community, and we share a common covenant, a commitment to come together in service to the beloved community. We light our chalice as our chalice lighting affirmation is shared, and the words are in your program if you wish to offer them aloud. Let us open our senses to take in the beauty. Let us open our minds to learn what is true. Let us open our hearts to love one another.
This is our time for all ages, and what we have for you is a dramatically presented poem by the Chicano poet Joseph Rios. Explaining this poem, Joseph Rios shares, "My family has lived on 8th and DeWitt in Clovis, California for almost 100 years. I wrote this poem after returning to live there and was overwhelmed by the ghosts awaiting me on every corner. Perhaps to prepare for this poem, you might recall a time when you returned home or returned to a place where you once lived and were greeted by ghosts or powerful memories, pulling you back to a time and a place that you no longer inhabited. We share this today on this first Sunday morning of the new year as an invitation to explore the way our personal history has a hold on us, but not a hold on what we cannot exceed."
Here's the poem. I'm on an errand to find my grandpa. I'm 10 and finding freedom in a sanctioned outing on my bike through the streets of Clovis, California. I roll past Silver's house and peek into the backyard of broke drunks holding paper bags around a barrel fire. One who just came back from around back is seasoning some carne they bought with the tall boys across the street at Numero Uno Market. The door chimes when I walk in and see Artemio's white mane. His mustache stretches from his nostrils to his sideburns and up into his waxed pomp of hair. My grandma says I'm not supposed to talk to him, but he always asks how she's doing. I don't see my grandpa any place. Art says he's around here somewhere. I go to Ruby's next door. I'm not allowed in, but I look in. I'm hit with a gust of cigarettes and Bud Light. Half a dozen heads turn my direction. No dice. I ride down Pulaski with feet out each way. I swerve left and right, free for once. I am this far from the shouting distance of my grandma. I take to the alley just for kicks and pop a wheelie behind the appliance shop. I pull up behind Henry's, knowing Grandpa's in there. A few other grandpas, too. I don't knock. I stay on my bike. I realize I'm not ready to go home, and like most men in this town, Grandpa doesn't want to be found. I keep riding. I go north to what's left of the railroad tracks. There's a gray cloud moving across the sky, and I imagine I'm chasing it. I'm right behind it. I keep riding until it's all oleanders and stacked railroad ties. I never thought I could go this far. I get off the seat and stand. I glide next to a forgotten caboose. I imagine I'm the howling train now. My tires kick dust as they crunch over the dry, dry dirt. I never thought I could go this far.
I never thought I could go this far.
Did you ever think you could go this far? That you could just keep going and get to where you are now?
Called to find depth in our days and to discover reverence in this hour, we seek a gentle meditation, a focused reflection, an ardent prayer, each as we are called yet mystically all together. And we enter into this space by hearing the lamentations, requests, and the remembrances of our community. Let us hear one another to heal one another. We light this first candle for the new year which arrived yesterday. May we treat 2022 as a chance for new beginnings, an opportunity to live more fully into our promise as individuals, as a congregation, even as a nation. We light this candle for all the people in this congregation, all the folks we know and love, and everyone everywhere who's struggling with COVID-19. We light this candle for the people of Colorado who this week suffered devastating wildfires. There are 3 people missing and 1,000 homes reported destroyed. We light this candle for the people of Kentucky caught amid catastrophic flooding, for people around the country terrorized by a spate of shootings, and for all those here and around the world who go without, whether it's due to lack of food or shelter, health or wealth, or companionship and peace of mind. And we light this final candle for the joys and sorrows deeply felt but left unspoken. And may we hold this silence as this silence holds us. May our listening bring forth acts of love. Please join me now in the spirit of prayer.
Spirit of life known in so many ways by so many names. Gracious power of love ever unfolding, known in many ways. We gather in the dawn of this new year, praying we find a different horizon than the one we were looking at all this past year, indeed since March 2020, when this pandemic began to change our lives. We have waded in the waters of possibility. We have committed ourselves to authenticity. And now we hope to build new ways of integrity, compassion, and power. A healthier, more life-affirming way of being that upholds everyone, despite their station or their afflictions or their identity. Fill us with the fire of commitment as we seek to do new things, or as we seek to do the old things in new ways, or find new joys in what must be done. Let us adjust our attitudes and assumptions to account for revelations and learning we have acquired along the way, and all those insights which will present themselves to us if only we are paying attention. Help us grow into more of the strong, wise, and loving people we truly are and can become. Grant us the strength to bring with us into this new year what is worthy and necessary. And fill us with courage to name and leave behind that which inhibits our thriving, that which destroys relationship, that which is an obstacle to love and to compassion, that which, even if we love it, serves us not. Keep before us the high resolve to keep going, to keep pedaling, so as to get us to where we need to be, to live more closely into our soul's promise, into our community's need, knowing that wherever caring and love abound, there the holy is also. In the name of all that each of us deems holy within, we pray. Amen.
Juliana and Paul, it is lovely to have you here. Such beautiful harmonies. and Michael such beautiful playing. Ubi caritas means where charity is, the holy is there. 80% of what you offer will care for our congregation, and 20% will support our December and January recipient, Fort House. Fort House stands for Forcing Out Recidivism Through Education. Fort House provides a healthy and transparent living environment for formerly incarcerated students transitioning through post-secondary education. Providing affordable housing and stability in the world of academia upon re-entry is paramount to the realization of Fort House mission. More information can be found at njforthouse.org. You can text UUCM plate and your amount to 73256. That's 73256 to give. You can mail us a check with Fort House in the memo, or simply place your gift in the offering basket. Ushers, please come forward. Gifts are worthy, and they are all received with love.
In just a bit, we are going to engage in our annual ritual of the fire communion. If you are joining us virtually, we encourage you to prepare a small piece of paper and a writing implement. If you are here in person, we encourage you to find that small piece of flash paper and pencil that you were given at the welcome desk. If you're missing either of these, please raise your hands and our greeters will bring them to you. What do you long to release? What from your past is holding you, trapping you, keeping you from going as far as you are called to go? Imagine if you could be set free from that, from whatever it is. Where could you go? Where could you go if it wasn't holding you? In a moment, we will hear our anthem. As you are moved, write or draw on your paper whatever it is you wish to release, or if you prefer, what you wish to be released from, a habit, a concern, a challenge, etc. When the time comes, we will burn this paper so that whatever it is that has a hold on you or us can fall to the ashes and we can carry on without it into the new year. Inside me.
What's that line, Juliana? Just because it's the way it's always been, don't mean it's the way it should be?
Yeah. That's exactly right.
And this is your song, right? You wrote this. And you have CDs available for purchase?
Not yet.
Okay. That is a beautiful, beautiful song and so perfect for today. So I'm gonna do a new thing. This comes from some of my favorite scripture from the book of Isaiah. I love the prophets and I love Isaiah. I love the book of Isaiah. And in Isaiah 43, 18 through 19, these are the words. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. In this passage, the prophet Isaiah is speaking for the holy, who is saying to the Hebrew people, your God is not bent on the same old, same old. Your God knows that we haven't hit perfection yet. We don't have to keep on doing the same things in the same ways. And this manifestation of the Holy, who is known to the Hebrew people, especially known to the Hebrew people through the prophets, as a God of righteousness, is making a way in the desert, is doing a new thing. So don't get set in your ways. Righteousness requires change. Don't you perceive it? Something is afoot. Something is happening. This is different, and the holy will make a way in the wilderness. Have we not found our ways in the wilderness? Don't get me wrong. It's still a wilderness. This is a wilderness of unjust, unrighteous, unequivocally, unnerving, uncontrollably, inconsolable, uncomfortable pandemic. This is a wilderness of loss. This is a wilderness of trauma. And yet, this God of Isaiah is speaking to us still, saying that we will make a way in the wilderness. Unfathomable. And yet, this God of Isaiah never made promises out of covenant. Here's the thing. The way in the wilderness would be made in partnership. The focus of this prophet's writing was always on the collective, on the whole, what we, what they could do in partnership with our understanding of the holy. So to make a way in the wilderness, it was understood that the Hebrew people would have to change personally to aid the larger project. Throughout this pandemic, the underprivileged have been unquestionably under the thumb of every unjust influence. And we are utterly unsettled in this unnatural time. But we are not undone. And perhaps we are making in partnership with the holy of our own understanding, in relationship with the love in our hearts that has no ending, perhaps we are making a way in the wilderness. Perhaps we are doing a new thing, right? We're doing a new thing. We've been kicked here, forced here, but we're doing it. We're doing a new thing. The story we heard earlier, the poem that was shared today as a story by the Chicano poet Joseph Rios, showed us that there are four things that we must do to ensure that we are not entrapped by our history, that we are not held back by our past. One, we must make choices that free us. We must make choices that free us. Joseph Rios chooses not to find his grandfather, but to keep on going on his own path. Two, we must then keep going. Keep going, following the way that we are called. Rev Scott was doing a good job of that on that bicycle. Three, we must bear witness to our own transformation. Rios' poem is proof of that. He's bearing witness to his own transformation. And four, we must assist the transformation of others. Our experience of Rios' poem is proof of that. That poem is a gift for us, so we can see the way another has gone on and kept going, and then put ourselves back in those same shoes and imagine what it's like for us to keep going, to keep moving, to choose ourselves, our own path, our freedom, and therefore to assist others to choose their own. So, one, choose. Two, keep going. Three, bear witness. Four, assist. Do you ever look back on your life and find yourself surprised that you're here, that you ended up in this place? There are ways that I look back on my life and see the trajectory in maybe not the best light. I can see how the mistakes I've made in my life have held me back in some ways, but usually there's a brighter path that I see as well. One where I can see how the smallest of choices that I made at one juncture or another made huge changes in the trajectory of my life. And it's almost like a path of stepping stones when I look back retrospectively and I see, well, I went there, so then I was able to go there, and then I could go there, and that's how I got here. Have you ever done that in your own mind? I'll take you through a piece of my story, and maybe it will fire a story for you. So when my father's father died, it was the first time I'd ever seen my father cry. My father, the strong one, the one who would always help everyone else when they were hurting. And then I looked up and I saw my father crying. And at first, I was afraid. What could I possibly do? But my mom, in her wisdom, said to me, "Your father needs you. All you need to do is sit close to him and hold his hand." And at first I was concerned, how could I do that? How could I hold my father's hand? He'd always held mine, as if there was a difference, right? But then I chose to follow my mom's suggestion, and through his pain, I kept finding myself finding him and sitting by his side and holding his hand and being present to pain, being present to another person's struggle. And you might imagine the stepping stones that I jumped from there to get here, to get to ministry. It was that choice of being close when someone else was hurting that allowed me to later be close to other people when they were hurting, and to learn that I had a calling to do that. That it was something that moved in me. A calling, not because I wanted people to hurt, but because I wanted them not to hurt, and to know that their pain was seen and held and witnessed. And so there was my experience in youth group some years later, and I found myself there, that I was the person that kept being asked to share the prayers and to hold the hands when people hurt. And then there was later my experience in college when my friends went through trauma, and I was the one that sat with them late night as they cried. And then there was that choice to go to seminary and to find my way here. Choose. Keep going. Bear witness, and then assist. I wonder sometimes how that choice will keep going beyond me. How that choice that I made way back then will keep going beyond me. How it will keep affecting people, places, and more for years into the future. Some positive, some negative, I'm sure. I'm not that naive. I know that even the choices that we make to follow our own calling can sometimes have negative effects on some. When I made the choice to become a minister, I lost many of my close friends from childhood. They didn't like religion, and I was then something strange to them. So even the positive choices that we make may have some negative influences. And I also wonder how the choices that seemed so personal, were aided, were foreshadowed, made possible by choices that others made 50 years ago, 100 years ago, and more. Choices like my great-grandfather Siegel, who chose the calling of rabbi. Choices like my mom who just kept going out of the abuse of her childhood to create a new life for herself and then for me. And choices like Olympia Brown's, the first woman to be ordained as a Universalist minister in 1863. I could never have made my choice without Olympia Brown making it. There's an idea that's called seven generation thinking, that is core to many sustainability practices. It's possible that this idea derived from the Iroquois people, but it's also quite possible that it originated in many spaces and places and was then altered and developed by a variety of peoples over time. Seventh generation thinking invites us to consider how our choices will affect not only our lives, but seven generations of life. Feels like a lot of pressure, doesn't it? Try this with me. Think back, perhaps to the stories that elders told you about your earliest days. Who was the eldest relative or intimate elder, now ancestor, that touched you? Who was the oldest person that had some effect on you? I'm using the word touch metaphorically, that had some effect on you when you were just very young. Maybe they were 80 or 90 years by then. Now imagine who the eldest person was that touched them when they were just an infant. 70, 80 years. Now consider the youngest person that you are in touch with, engaged with. Now imagine the extension of their life into the future, and then imagine that infant growing and touching another. Here's the thing, we have the capacity to reach back into the past 180 years and into the future 180 years. This is a 360 year period over which one may be known and may know others. In other words, the choices that we make, even those that seem personal, intimate, have an effect far beyond our living. So look back into your past and imagine your trajectory to the present moment. Can't believe you made it here from there, right? It was just a series of seemingly tiny choices, a decision to do this and not that, a choice to act justly, to live with more kindness, to love with less fear. And you just kept going. And your choices will keep going far beyond your existence to the seventh generation that will succeed you. I don't say this to put pressure on you. Ray's feeling the pressure. I can see it in your I don't see this to put pressure on you. This is an opportunity to see ourselves and our choices as far more powerful than we might imagine them to be. Sometimes we think our lives are insignificant, and they are not. It can be mighty uninteresting to make choices that I believe will only benefit me. I'm not saying that I don't do this. Of course I do. I make those kind of choices all the time, but those are not the kind of choices I want to make in a ritual manner here on the Sunday of New Year's. The kind of choice I hope that you will make today is one that takes into account those who came before and those that will come after. The kind of choice that will help you continue to make a way in the wilderness, a way that may extend seven generations into the future. We have the chance now to choose what to let go, what to leave in the past, what we don't want to repeat again and again in the new year. So what can you leave behind so that descendants decades into the future will know greater freedom and peace? When we see the smoke rise as we do our fire communion, know that it rises for generations to come. Amen. And we are going to move now to our fire communion. Rev Scott, can you please light the, and bring your paper, if you will please light the fire in our fire communion vessel. And then Rev Scott is going to demonstrate, I don't know, are you the right person to do this? Okay. Rev Scott is going to demonstrate how to use flash paper, Flash paper, I should say, is paper that is designed to burn up quickly. We're gonna bring a few more pieces of flash paper up. Sorry, thank you, David. And we're gonna demonstrate some different ways to do this. Again, if you are joining us virtually, hopefully you have your own paper and your own pen, and you have the bright outdoors of the day to burn this paper later. We hope you will, or in a fireplace or near a sink, somewhere safe. Here in this sanctuary, Rev Scott is gonna show us how fire paper works. Did that burn your hand, Rev Scott?
No.
No, it did not. Let go of the paper if you don't like the feel of heat. Are you really the right person to be doing this? He would not recommend throwing it into the air for a small person. For a young person, however, if a young person would like to participate, we can do that when you are, if an adult with them is holding the paper with them and helps them to let go. Okay, so the way we're gonna do this, I invite you to keep socially distant as you walk to the edges, to the aisles, to come forward. Judith and Rev Scott will be present nearby. If you would rather that they do your flash paper for you, they are glad to receive your flash paper and put it in the flame, or they will stand back, make sure that they're socially distant, and invite you to burn your own flash paper. And Michael, thank you so much for playing a little bit as we do this ritual. Come on forward. From one side, then the other.
Thank you.
Debbie Ann and Connor, who are up there in our tech booth. Do you want to come down and participate? You are welcome to. David will make sure that you get some flash paper when you come down. Or another greeter, David, however. Woo-hoo! Has everyone who's wanted to had a chance? I welcome you then to Rev Scott and Judith. If you will please put your hands above. And if you are so moved, I welcome you to raise your hands forward into this space towards the fire in the chalice. May what we have let go leave. May it leave, leave, leave as we move on, as we keep going. May it be turned to ash, not ash that will hold us back, but ash that will blow in the wind and be gone. May it move back as we move forward. Amen. We're going to share now our closing song, which is The Fire of Commitment. The Fire of Commitment.
From fear.
deep assurance of the flame that burns within, then our future can begin. Woo. Will you reflect with me? Where can you go now that you have been released? Released to do a new thing. Where can you go now? Now that you have been released, released to do a new thing. Let's extinguish our chalice. Gratitude to the tech team, the greeters, all who made this worship possible. It's been so good to share in a fire communion with those virtual and those present. Now go do a new thing.
Yeah, man.